Professor Dave here. Let's talk about Grignard reactions.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So as I said before, it's very important for us to develop techniques in which we can generate new carbon-carbon bonds. Now, nature has its own ways of doing this, but there are some that we have invented all on our own. So let's take a look at one called the Grignard reaction that was developed in 1912 and won the Nobel Prize, because this is a very important reaction that we use quite a bit today. So let's look at what's going on here. Let's say we have a typical alkyl halide. Let's say it's an alkyl bromide. Well, we know that a carbon-halogen bond is polar, right? Because of the discrepancy in electronegativity. So, and the electrons are polarizable. So we're going to have a partial positive charge and we're going to have a partial negative charge over here. And that is what we are typically looking at when we're looking at a carbon-halogen bond. Now, what Grignard discovered was that this interacts with magnesium in a very interesting way in anhydrous conditions. So this is diethyl ether, is the typical solvent for the Grignard reaction. And so magnesium is somehow able to insert itself into the carbon-halogen bond. So this works for alkyl bromides. We can use alkyl chlorides as well. And so magnesium is able to insert itself directly into that bond. So now we have carbon connected to magnesium, which is connected to bromine, okay? And now what that does that's interesting is it actually inverts the polarity of that bond because magnesium is actually less electronegative than carbon. So now all of a sudden carbon is the one with the partial negative charge and the magnesium is the partial positive charge. So this is a very interesting situation because typically carbon is partially positive in most organic compounds, whether it is a carbonyl carbon or it is attached to a halogen or something like that. So this is a rare source of nucleophilic carbon, right? We have a carbon that can behave as a nucleophile because it has some electron excess, okay? So this is called the Grignard reagent. It is an alkyl halide with magnesium inserted into the carbon-halogen bond. Grignard reagents react with carbonyl-containing compounds like aldehydes and ketones. So let's take a look at what happens. Let's say we have a 3-carbon Grignard reagent here. And let's say this reacts with a 2-carbon aldehyde. So I've got the 3 red carbons here, and then the 2 carbons on the electrophile here, the aldehyde. So what happens is the partially negative, remember that now this is a nucleophilic carbon, this carbon with its electrons to the magnesium will go ahead and attack the carbonyl carbon. We know that carbonyls also have a dipole, right? We know that the carbonyl carbon is partially positive. And the oxygen is partially negative because the oxygen is more electronegative than the carbon. So partial negative reacts with partial positive. All we need is some electron excess and some electron deficiency, and we have a chemical reaction. So this carbon attacks this carbon, pushes the pi bond up here to generate the oxyanion. And now look at what has happened. We have this 3-carbon fragment and this 2-carbon fragment, and we have generated a new carbon-carbon bond between those 2 carbons. Now with the Grignard reaction, it will always, always, always be the carbon that is bound to the magnesium, which is the nucleophilic carbon, is forming a new covalent bond with the carbonyl carbon, okay? So this and this are now connected, so there's our new bond there, and then the other carbon is there too. And then an oxyanion, this will the MgBr plus will kind of hang out near the oxyanion. So this is it, one step real quick. We've generated this, and then a little bit of aqueous acidic workup, and we'll protonate that, and we will get our 5-carbon alcohol. So this is a very powerful technique, because in one step, we can assemble a larger carbon skeletal structure. We've got a 3-carbon fragment and a 2-carbon fragment, and now we have a 5-carbon alcohol. So this can be very powerful. The one thing that we want to summarize is that a Grignard reagent will react with a carbonyl-containing compound in order to generate an alcohol. So Grignard products are alcohols. They must have a hydroxyl group in them. And then the one thing that we want to understand here is that Grignard reactions must be done in strictly anhydrous conditions. There can be no water at all to mess with this reaction, because if a water molecule comes into contact with a Grignard reagent, so here's a general Grignard reagent, R just means alkyl, could be anything, right? Couple of carbons, whatever it is, then this nucleophilic carbon, the proton in a water molecule is just acidic enough that this is going to go ahead and interact with that proton. You'll get an alkane, and you'll completely destroy your Grignard reagent, and then this is an unusable byproduct. So a Grignard reagent will be destroyed if it comes into contact with a water molecule, even in the atmosphere. So certainly the solvent itself must be completely anhydrous. There can be no water molecules in solution. It must be something like a diethyl ether. So these are the general characteristics of a Grignard reaction. Now let's look at a couple more specific examples to make sure we understand. So, Grignard reagents can react with many carbonyl-containing compounds. Before, we saw a Grignard reagent reacting with an aldehyde. Now let's look at one reacting with a ketone. It's basically the same thing. So here's our carbonyl-containing compound. It's a ketone. And now let's say we have a methyl Grignard reagent. So we have CH3MGBr. So this is going to be the partially negative carbon. We'll go and attack the carbonyl carbon, and we'll get the oxyanion, and then acidic workup, and we'll have our alcohol product. So this carbon was there and remains there, could be either of these, and then one more carbon is going to be attached. And so here's our alcohol product. Now, Grignard reagents will not react with carboxylic acids, because that's just not going to work, but esters actually generate a pretty interesting thing. So let's say we have the same Grignard reagent, and we have this ester. Now, what can happen is that this methyl can attack here, will generate the oxyanion. Now, instead of going ahead and neutralizing, what can happen is this can reform the carbonyl right there, but then kick off this alkoxy group. This alkoxy group could be stable in solution. And so what we've done is we've added the methyl group. Here's that new methyl group that came from this Grignard reagent. That's there. And then this went and kicked off the alkoxy group. So we've reformed the carbonyl right there. Now, if we have this Grignard reagent in excess, what is going to be able to happen is we could add another equivalent of the Grignard reagent, because we have a ketone here now. We already saw that a Grignard reagent can react with this. And so we're going to be able to add another equivalent of the Grignard reagent there, generate the oxyanion, acidic workup, and go ahead and get this product here, just as we would over here. So there's different pathways, and what's powerful with an ester substrate is that you can add two of the same Grignard reagent to the same molecule, possibly generating a much larger molecule in the process. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials, and as always, feel free to email me with questions, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.